Good evening and welcome to St. John's for this annual Veterans Service. This year, we are having a smaller service and we are live streaming it. I'd like to say welcome to all those who are joining us through live stream. I'd also like to say welcome to those from throughout the deanery who are with us tonight as well. While we chose not to make this a formal deanery event, it's good to know that we have the custom of gathering together on this night. Our service is printed in your service bulletin, and we begin with the prelude. Ryan, take it from here.
Thank you.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O Judge of Nations, we remember before you with grateful hearts the men and women of our country who in the day of decision ventured much for the liberties we now enjoy. Grant that we may not rest until all people of this land share the benefits of true freedom and gladly accept its disciplines. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the first letter of John. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In his love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment. Because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, I love God, and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God, whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. The word of the Lord. Thank you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I call you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. At the beginning of 2020, I began my sabbatical and got about 4 weeks into it. I got a lot of research done on, or at least gathered information about the roots of the Armed Services Prayer Book. And then COVID-19 hit in force. And we're still living with the impact of the restrictions that we live under. And this night, we miss not being able to gather in a larger community. When we came to the conclusion that we would use members of St. John's to lead this service, I am acutely aware that I have not served. I'm also acutely aware that this year, given COVID, that someone who was in the military and also in the healing profession would be perfect to address us tonight. And Dixon, thank you for being willing to do so. Two things before I invite Dixon to ascend the pulpit. First, I discovered that the earliest attempt that I could find by the Episcopal Church to do a prayer book for the Army and the Navy was done in New York in the early 1840s. A group of officers came together and wanted a prayer book that would enable the officers to hold services when a priest or minister was not available. So it's long been the duty of officers to fill the pulpit when needed. And also, I received a gift not long after COVID started. It's my custom to give out Armed Services prayer books to those who are serving. This time, someone who has been deployed a number of times overseas and had taken the prayer book with him, did not take the prayer book on a routine training exercise when COVID was present. So he went to his chaplain and asked if he could have not one Armed Services prayer book, but two. And he was kind enough to inscribe it to me during this pandemic. We live in community, and the love that we show for one another is the center of our gospel message this morning. Evening, yes, it's evening, not morning. And it's also true that whether a soldier or sailor in the field or at sea is alone, or a Christian is alone, We are diminished and we are strengthened in community. So Dixon, Dr. Dixon Schaefer, Colonel Dixon Schaefer, welcome and thank you for addressing us this evening.
I'd like to begin by expressing my appreciation for all the veterans of our armed forces, especially the long list of veterans from St. John's. As we've just been through the most contentious election of my lifetime, I'm especially aware of the precious right to vote for our leadership. This right and many other rights have been fought for and protected by those who are willing to stand and defend our country and all of her rights. Years ago, my father-in-law was considered for one of the top law enforcement jobs in the country. The presidential election went the other way, and this did not come to pass. The job change was not necessarily good for him, so I asked him what he would have done if he'd been nominated. His response was, "It's awfully hard to tell the president no." This is true service. This also must have been on my mind when Robert asked me to speak today. It's awfully hard to tell the rector no. So with that, I will do my best to make meaningful comments. My wife and I have been watching Blue Bloods recently. Matter of fact, we've been quarantined, so we've been binge watching, and I think we've knocked out 7 seasons in 4 weeks, a pretty good clip. On one episode, Frank, who's the commissioner of the police department of New York, and his two sons who are cops, and his daughter's assistant district attorney. So one episode, Frank had a problem, and he went to the archbishop for his advice. At dinner that night, the father asked Frank if he'd gotten his answer, and Frank said, "I'm not really sure." And he said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Well," he quoted a whole bunch of scripture, and I gotta admit, my knowledge of scripture is not so great, so I'm gonna have to do some research to find out what he meant. And I too am deficient in my knowledge of scripture. As Mark Twain once said, it's better to remain silent and thought a fool than open one's mouth and remove all doubt. So with that, I will not be quoting the scripture. Several times I've been asked to speak at different events, including the graduation at Methodist University. And each time I've had the thought of what can I say that will have meaning to my audience. I'm simply an ordinary man living in an ordinary community with no fame or accolades to draw people to hear me speak. But for some reason I was asked, and I'm honored to do so. I felt that speaking on service to others, and particularly military service today, would be appropriate. And I assure you, especially as I look out in the congregation tonight, as thin as we are because of distancing, I know that the service that those of here who have served have provided. And I'm certainly the least qualified in this room to speak on the virtues of military service. St. John's has a long history of its members serving the military, certainly from the War of 1812 until today. And I have no proof that Robert may well, the soldiers of the Revolutionary War later became members of St. John's. These members have served as role models and mentors to many of the younger members. Men such as Edmund Lilly. Our members will remember him as Tad. Tad fought in World War II in the Philippines, survived the Bataan Death March. His son Teddy served in Korea, was in the West Point class of 1950, and was killed in action 3 months after graduation. Still today, there are dedicated members, male and female, serving. This latest generation of service members has been serving a longer period of sustained combat than ever before in our history. There are a couple of them who deploy so much that I don't call her a Sunday that we didn't pray for them. Being raised in St. John's and knowing these men and women has had a profound effect on me. They certainly served in our military, but they were also leaders in our church and community. They served as examples of loving our Lord, expressing their love for their neighbors, both in action and in words, and in improving the quality of life for our community, locally, statewide, and nationally. Their service was certainly a major reason I decided to join the Army Reserves. Veterans Day is our day to honor all veterans. We honor their service and their sacrifice. Many have left their homes and families at a young age to fight in the wars and return to establish their own families and establish careers. Unfortunately, many did not return. All of them have sacrificed comforts of being at home with family, missed family events, and suffered physical and psychological hardships. We owe all of them a debt of gratitude. While Veterans Day is a day to remember and honor our veterans, I would also like to remember all of their loved ones, as their military service has a profound impact on them as well. When thinking of why veterans are so special, for me it comes to their servant attitude. Isn't this what God expects of all of us? Isn't this why Jesus suffered on the cross? This is the true expression of love for one another, to serve. From the gospel today we heard, I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. And the last sentence, I'm giving these commands so that you may love one another. This is the fruit of our efforts. This could be volunteer work in the church and our community. It could be through our professions, and it could be by living a Christian life and simply being involved in the lives of others. But as God instructs, our efforts should have lasting benefits. Ralph Waldo Emerson famously quoted, "It is one of the most beautiful compensations in life that no man can truly try to help another without helping himself." Heard this from my father many times. This is the servant attitude that God expects from all of us. As I have matured, I have found this to be very true. And maybe we simply have a feeling of satisfaction knowing that we have carried out God's will. At times there may also be a material gain. Personally, I have the most satisfaction when I know I have helped someone where there's no potential for gain personally. It is in those times I feel I am best following God's commandments. There are daily examples of this at St. John's. It is the parishioner that calls on a shut-in, a dinner delivered, a comforting voice in a time of despair, and yes, the parishioner who develops a check to fund an unfunded need. As I collected my thoughts today, I realized we rely on the service of the ordinary person much more than that of the extraordinary person. To use the oft-quoted, the ordinary person doing extraordinary things. While the extraordinary things are obviously necessary, isn't it the ordinary things by ordinary people that have the most impact on our daily lives? If we wait to make an extraordinary impact, then most of us will spend our lives waiting. However, each one of us can leave here tonight and make an immediate, ordinary impact. It could be as simple as a friendly greeting as we leave this place of worship. We could be the bright spot in the day of a person who is lonely and afraid. And this is God's will. By seeking to serve our Lord, we find many ways to serve our neighbor. As I close, I again express appreciation for all the men and women that wear the uniform. Every day they live by God's commandment to serve. We honor the sacrifice of them and their families. However, military service is certainly not suited for everyone. I offer that we honor their service by following their example and serving our Lord as we are called to do. Thank you.
Let us now stand, and together with all people of faith throughout the ages and across the globe, now reaffirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God,
Amen.
When we serve in the military or serve in the church, sometimes we have to be ready to act in the moment. We have among us a deacon in our deanery, and would you please come, Mary Mack, would you come forward and lead us in the prayers of the people? And I will pick up at the Litany of Remembrance. Please come to the microphone since we're doing the live stream. Thank you.
In peace we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work.
Our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For Donald, our president, Roy, our governor, Mitch, our mayor, and for this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
The victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
Remembering all those for whom our prayers are desired.
For those who minister to the sick, friends, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Rob, our bishop, Carl, Bishop for Armed Forces and Federal Ministries, and for all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God in His church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation. We commend to your gracious care in keeping all the men and women of our armed forces at home and abroad. Defend them with your grace. Strengthen them in their trials. Give them courage to face the perils which beset them. And grant them a sense of your abiding presence wherever they may be. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
Praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, and that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Put their trust in you. A litany of remembrance. Let us remember before God and commend to his sure keeping those who have died for their country in conflict, those whom we know and whose memory we treasure, and all who have lived and died in the service of humanity.
They shall grow old, they shall grow old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn.
At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
We will remember them. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. One of the most powerful parts of this service when we gather as a deanery is to have our clergy join in the laying on of hands for all those who request healing. As with so many other things this night, we will not come forward for the laying on of hands, but I invite you to pray for healing. As we do so, let me offer one other learning from my time away during sabbatical. I always knew that my father had finished high school at Church Farm School, a working farm, and had gone straight from high school to serve in Germany. And I knew that his uncle, who was old enough to be his father, had finished med school and had gone to England and become a highly skilled surgeon because of the work that he was called to do, the difficult, challenging work, the life-saving work that he was called to do at that time. I knew that Dad had taken leave and gone, and my uncle and my father had enjoyed a pheasant hunt, and in Dad's trunk, he had some of the pheasant feathers from that hunt. I knew that Uncle Doc and Dad were close. It wasn't until I talked with some of my first cousins who were old enough to be my parents that they told me another part of the story. That other part of the story was that when Uncle Doc and Dad got home from World War II and came back to the farm, they spent a whole month building a cabin. Now, they didn't need a cabin, but they needed to do something during that time. Something that they could do together and something that would let them heal or help them to begin healing. At least I suspect that was what was going on. I will never know for sure. But when I heard about that endeavor, I listened to a piece of scripture, Dixon, in a little bit different way. We shall take swords and beat them into plowshares, and spears and beat them into pruning hooks. Such an endeavor is intentional. It takes time. And I sort of suspect when people came back from war and engaged in that sort of activity, in doing those actions, healing began to occur. We are now 20 years into a conflict where some are going off to war and some have come home, and the need for healing and support is real. I pray that Fayetteville and this parish and this deanery will continue to be a place of support in times of joy and sorrow, a place where we can accept one another and our needs, and also help one another further along that path of healing. Savior of the world, by your cross and precious blood, you have redeemed us.
Save us
and help us. We humbly beseech you, O Lord. I now offer one prayer from the Armed Services Prayer Book and one prayer of healing that we normally use on Wednesday nights. From the Armed Services Prayer Book, it's a prayer for individuals. It's a prayer that I will use we instead of me as we offer it corporately. It's a prayer for recovery from sickness. It's a prayer that is for all who are in need of restoration to wholeness of life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Spirit of healing, visit us, your children, and your power renew health within us and raise us up in joy, according to your loving kindness, for which we give thanks and praise. through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. As we receive the healing power of God's Spirit this night, may our Heavenly Father grant us the inward anointing of the Holy Spirit of His great mercy. May He forgive you your sins, release you from your suffering, and restore you to wholeness and strength. May He deliver you from all evil, preserve you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please stand. Peace of the Lord be always with you. Peace be with you. Peace. Peace. I only have three things to say this night. One, thank you for coming this night to remember and support our veterans, and thanks to all who currently serve and who have served. Second, I would like for all of you to join me in a round of thanks. Make it noisy. To Christian, thank you for your And finally, just as we miss not being able to receive the bread and wine, though we will celebrate the Eucharist, it has been our custom as we gather for worship to offer a prayer for communion with Christ, which comes directly from our Armed Services prayer book. So we hear the words of consecration, receive Christ spiritually, and as we do so, we find ourselves in the same place as so many throughout the world as we pray that prayer at the table in a moment. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us in offering and sacrifice to God.
Mind.
Service continues with Eucharistic Prayer B, found printed in your service bulletin. Please stand. Blessed art thou, O Lord God, King of the universe. Through your gracious goodness we have this bread and wine which earth has given and human hands have made. They will become our spiritual food. Blessed be God forever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father, Almighty Creator of heaven and earth, for with your co-eternal Son and Holy Spirit, you are one God, one Lord, in trinity of persons and in unity of being, and we celebrate the one and equal glory of you, O Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son and his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Have
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Let us pray in the words of a prayer for communion with Christ. In union, O Lord, with your faithful people, at every altar of your church, where the Holy Eucharist is now being celebrated, we desire to offer you praise and thanksgiving. We remember your death, Lord Christ. We proclaim your resurrection. We await your coming in glory. And since we cannot receive you today in the sacrament of your body and blood, we beseech you to come spiritually into our hearts. Cleanse and strengthen us with your grace, Lord Christ Jesus, and let us never be separated from you. May we live in you and you in us in this life and the life to come. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen. Bless the Lord.